no.
Distinguished guests, dear colleagues, dear participants of the conference, it is my distinct pleasure to welcome you in the name of the organizing committee to our conference, Great Transformation, Global Perspectives on Contemporary Capitalism. The conference is the common project of the Institute of Political Science at the University of Vienna, Ulrich Bonn, Birgit Sauer, and Dieter Siebert, the research group Postgrowth Societies at the Friedrich Schiller Universität Jena, Glasgow, the Institute for Comprehensive Analysis of the Economy at the Johannes Kepler University Linz, Jakob Capella, and the Institute of Sociology at the Johannes Kepler University Linz, Roland Arzmüller, me, David Auenbacher, Fabienne Monsieur, and Karin Fischer. We are very happy to welcome you, participants from around the world, and wish you a wonderful stay at the University of Johannes Kepler University in Linz and in Austria. In this opening, we will take four steps. First, we will hear the welcome addresses of the rector of the University of Johannes Kepler University, Professor Manuel Lucas, the deputy mayor of Linz, Magister Christian Forstenreiter, the head of Tourist Board Linz, Director Steiner, and the head of the Department of Socioeconomics of the Institute for Multilevel Governance and Development of the Vienna University of Economics and Business, Professor Andreas Mühl. Thank you very much for addressing the conference. I have to apologize to Federal Council member Magister Klaus Föhlinger and the Dean of the Faculty of Social Sciences, Economics and Business, Professor Jürgen Bacher, who are not able to come. Very special thanks goes to the Dean, Jürgen Bacher, who would have liked to be here as sociologist too. Without his support, so many things would not have been possible. Second step will be some short remarks that will introduce you in the conference theme. The third step, at the center of this opening, we hear and discuss the speech of Professor Michael Burroy, University of California, Berkeley, USA, on Karl Polanyi today. Thank you very much, Michael, for coming to Linz and in anticipation for all these further contributions to the conference. So thank you very much to all of you for being here. And the fourth and last step will be some organizational details before we then will invite you to join the class Austrian wine and beer with us and to come in touch with each other. So before we will take these four steps, it is my distinct pleasure to welcome one colleague in the audience too. We are very honored and delighted that Karl Polanyi Livid will contribute to our conference and will give insights in her father's work at life in a conversation with Michael Burroy. Very welcome, Kari, and thank you very much for being here. On this conference are many international, most renowned experts who have done most impressive research on contemporary capitalism and or on Karl Polanyi. I would have loved to mention you all, but decided not to risk to forget one. And therefore, I would like to welcome you without mentioning names. We are very honored and that you have made your way to this conference and will discuss your work with us. First, I now would like to ask Jakob Capella to read the welcome address of director of the Johannes Kepler University, who is ill and cannot speak, and therefore he sent his welcome address.
Yeah, many thanks. Our foreign guests might wonder, given the current weather conditions, whether Austrians are really immune to the cold. So the fact that you have to accept me as a substitute for our director gives permanent proof to the fact that we are actually not. Having said this, I hope you will take his words over from my mouth. Dear Deputy Mayor Posteleitner, distinguished guests, distinguished members of the Scientific Symposium, welcome dear Ms. Polani-Lewick and welcome dear Professor Barrow. Thank you all for coming the way to the University of Linz to join us in this conference. I'm very pleased to welcome you all here today at Johannes Kepler University Linz. It is a great honor for our university that we can bring back Polani's work into the discussion in Austria by means of this event. I would especially like to thank Professor Brigitte Aurenbacher, who has made this event possible with her staff and her relentless effort. I appreciate the cooperation with other universities, which creates synergy effects for students and researchers alike. The topic of this conference, A Great Transformation, Global Perspectives on Contemporary Capitalism, takes up the current theme of change. At the university as well as in society as a whole, current transformations and developments in the relationship between politics and economics, both at national and international level, have to be researched scientifically and brought to the public's attention. 2016 was characterized by political and social transformations and disruptions. We are looking back at the referendum in the UK, the output of which shook the foundations of the European Union. The judges, journalists, artists and scholars were arrested directly at the EU's border in this year. The United States of America elected a man who wants to resolve the worries of the forgotten man. And in Austria we have experienced the presidential election which will enter the history books. Overall, much of the change is characterized by a strong tension in society, which no longer seems to trust politics and markets. Most recently, the Oxford Dictionary announced the word of the year 2016, post-truth. It describes the circumstances in which objective facts are less influential in shaping public opinion than appeals to emotion or personal attitudes. As you can see again, we need scientific answers to these major to confront these major developments. I am convinced that this will be successful, and you are making a valuable contribution with this conference. The topics range wide from the political crisis to degrowth of fictitious commodities to transformation and counter-movements, just to name a few sessions and passwords. It is, overall, a very impressive program that you've experienced here. In the name of our rector, I would like to sincerely thank the entire organization team for making this conference possible at Johannes Kepler University of Linz. I wish you interesting lectures and stimulating discussions. Good luck for this conference.
Thank you very much, Jakob, for doing this. The Johannes Kepler University is collaborating in many fields with Linz. The pre-conference yesterday evening has been an event of public science in the Knowledge Tower in collaboration with the Magistrate of Linz. Therefore, it is a great pleasure to have the Deputy Mayor, Magister Christian Forstner-Leitner, here, and I would like to ask you for your welcome address.
Dear Professor Aurenbacher, dear Professor Lewick, dear Professor Borowoy, dear honored guests, on behalf of the Mayor of the City of Linz, Klaus Luger, I would like to welcome you to our city. It is an honor for us that your conference takes place in Linz. Linz is a growing city with about 200,000 inhabitants and is especially known for its industry, especially the steel producing industry. But it's also a creative city now, with for example, the International Ars Electronica Festival, and our goal is to be also a second city for perhaps even the most interesting city, but certainly the most innovative city in Austria. The great transformation offers some valuable insights for me too. For example, in a market economy, politics and companies are connected in various ways. Certainly, we as politicians strive to create the necessary conditions for companies to prosper. In Linz, for example, we heavily invest in primary education, in healthcare, social services, but also basic infrastructure, not only, but also for our companies to succeed. It would be naive to assume that modern capitalism would work without the heavy investment and input of states and communities. Linz is a good example for this. Politics, at least good politics, is far from powerless. It is and remains a daily struggle to exercise our democratic influence and to materialize the public interest. In this struggle, it would be fatal to rely on so-called natural forces and the so-called free market as provided shoulders. I want to congratulate and thank especially the Institute of Sociology and Professor Olmbacher and the Institute for the Comprehensive Analysis of the Economy, Dr. Capella, for organizing and hosting this great conference. The City of Linz expects the University to engage in public discourse and to this end also proudly sponsors the Johannes Kepler University. Specifically, speaking in this room, we helped the University together with the Upper Austrian government to renew this conference room, and actually you are the first to enjoy it and to use it. We hope you enjoy your stay in Linz, in our city, and have the chance not only to attend the conference, but also to see something of our beautiful city. I wish you all the best for the conference.
The conference. We have the flyer of it in the conference bags. And we are very happy that we can offer you a guided tour of the exhibition and the plant of Fürst Alpine. Usually this tour is done in the nights of the museums and they do it extraordinarily for us for the conference. Therefore it is a great pleasure that Director Georg Steiner will address the conference.
Honored guests, ladies and gentlemen, let me say a very warm welcome in behalf of the Tourist Board of Linz. We are very happy that you are here, not only in Linz, especially in general in Linz. All over the year, Linz is a very interesting city, but in January we have a lot of time. You find a city that are not so many people, and we have time to discuss very interesting issues like this conference. Thank you to the organization committee. Thank you to you for coming to Linz. And now, I, as the director of tourism, what is my message? Say Linz, say change is the slogan. What is the branding of Linz? What is the marketing of Linz? I think it's a very good slogan also for your conference, for the Polanyi issues what you have to discuss. And for me it's very important what you tell when you come back to your friends, to your family, to your colleagues. And I hope some things what our vice mayor did say to you and some things what I try to bring as a message to you. Linz is a contemporary city, and in Linz we don't look back in a romantic way to all churches, to all ruins, to all things. Linz is living now, and we have a lot of titles, like 2009, Linz as European Capital of Culture, and since December 2014, Linz as UNESCO City of Media Arts. And Media Arts is a very big title where you can bring a lot of things. As examples, the Arts Electronica Center, but a lot of other artistic activities what you can find in Linz. Linz is a successful city in our time. And a successful city in our time, there are Nazi castles and the big churches. There is life quality, the essence of our success, and life quality concludes ecological things. Linz has a very successful industry, but the air is very clean. I think it's a very interesting development. Linz has a lot of culture, but not only culture for experts of the whole world, culture for our people, for our inhabitants. And Linz is a very social city. The social aspect bridges between rich and poor, and also the problems in connection with immigrants. I think we had a very good development, a very good climate in Linz, and a very good situation. What you should feel when you are in Linz over these days, and I think Polanyi, I hope you find that Linz is a very good example to have answers to see things what in our time are very, very, very important. We say to our guests, do not look to all things what you know, stay curious. Steve Jobs said, stay foolish, stay hungry. And these are my messages to you. I wish you a very good stay, very interesting stay, good discussions, and I hope you have so many things that you come back to Linz in one of the next year. Thank you that you are here, and I wish you a very successful conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this welcome address of Linz Tourism. And a very special thank goes to Professor Andreas Mobi, who is in the collaboration partner of the organizing committee, being very supportive concerning the visit of Karin Polanyi-Levit in Vienna and in Linz. Thank you very much, Andreas.
Yeah, thank you very much from my side as well. First, I want to congratulate the organizers for this courageous initiative to use the main artwork of Karin Polanyi for understanding the transformations of contemporary capitalism. Reminding and honoring a non-academic, non-economist to study contemporary economic development is not the conventional way of doing economics. Putting a puzzling phenomenon, the ongoing deep socio-ecological, political, economic changes, instead of disciplinary defined theories, models, methods, at center stage is not the conventional way of doing science. I am head of the Institute of Multilevel Governance and Development at the Wirtschaftsuniversität Wien. This large business school has always had niches for alternative economic thinking. Over the last years, a proper department of socioeconomics has been created. Its aspirations can be read at the department website. It is very Polanyian. I will first cite it in German due to its lyric undertone. Die Sozioökonomie ruft in Erinnerung, dass die Wirtschaft in die Gesellschaft und die Natur eingebettet ist. That's the first sentence. Socioeconomics reflects the embeddedness of the economy into society and biophysical nature. prompted by actually anticipated crises, it utilizes a range of diverse approaches and methodologies to describe, understand, and explain socio-economic, political, and ecological development. End of citation. Given this mission statement, I'm happy that we participate at this event, as it uses a socio-economic, a colonial lens to interpret the current changes at home Earth. Even the rector mentioned this last year, 2016, with its rather dramatic events. The two aspects in this conference are especially important for our department. First, economic analysis has to be multidimensional, acknowledging that markets are politically created, institutionalized by human beings. That is not the normal way of studying the economy. Economics is a way of looking at the world with an optimizing lens, not trying to understand what is really going on. In this sense, the attempt here to study contemporary capitalism as an interdisciplinary undertaking is very much acknowledged. Second, in times of Brexit and Trump, Polanyi offers a specific interpretation which conflicts with the mainstream, with the liberal mainstream. Instead of defending liberal globalization against its enemies, and somehow that was the Trump, Clinton, the Van der Bellen, Hofer divide, Polanyi denounced an illusionary liberalism as being a decisive part of the problem. In times of neoliberal globalization, testing this claim for the current situation is a very worthwhile undertaking, as it is of crucial importance in the best of our civilization while overcoming some of its shortcomings. And I'm also very happy that we participate here, myself and my colleagues, as in a few weeks we will organize at our university an event, the Good Life for All Congress, which is very much in tune and in line with the deliberations here, as our key kind of thesis we want to explore, test, and deepen is that we claim that without a selective economic deglobalization, no good life for all is possible. Polanyi had this conviction in the 1940s. Whether and in how far that's relevant today will be part of our discussions here. It will be part of our Good Life for All conference in February at the Vienna University. In the second, at the library, at the Bücherfisch, you can find leaflets and take them home. So I'm looking forward to four inspiring days and to the presentation by Michael Bolloway. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Andreas, for our trusting conference. And last but not least, I have to add a very special thank to the Mauthausen Memorial for inviting the conference on Friday for a lecture and guided tour to inform us about this chapter of Austrian history forcing Calculani to leave the country. So I think that's very important that we have this opportunity to see the Mauthausen Memorial. And very special thank goes to the Chamber of Labor, Vienna, and to the Republic, the Fund of the Republic of Austria, because they have found grants for contributions from the sea countries and for university who are not able to refund accommodation or travel costs, and the Fund of the Republic of Austria and the Chamber of Labor in Vienna has been very helpful to realize such a conference in collaboration with institutions of the Global South too. In the second step, please let me only make some short remarks concerning the character of this conference. It is conceptualized to bring global perspectives on contemporary capitalisms into a common discussion. For some decades, we are witnessing a deep-going change of capitalisms discussed in terms of crisis, consolidation, reform, transition, transformation, and many more. Together with the first idea to make such a conference, we thought about three questions. How can we come into a common analysis and discussion in a wide range of theories, terms, themes, findings, by which researchers from around the world try to understand what happens today? And how can we think and talk about the dominant tendencies as well as about alternatives and alternative visions of another society? And the third and last question, what could run through the conference like a thread? The answer given to this last question has been Karl Polanyi's The Great Transformation. And therefore, the title and the concept of the conference refers very specifically to Karl Polanyi. We are asking whether we are witnessing a new great transformation of capitalism. Of course, we know that we will not find an answer on this conference, but we can show what are important developments we have to consider. And we can discuss how we could do this. How can we refer to Karl Polanyi, who gave us so many inspiring ideas to reflect on the market, the state, and the civil society, on the history of science and society, on labor, land, and money as fictitious commodities, on the liberal creed, on the movement and the counter-movement, and so many more. How do we have to read Karl Polanyi in his historical context, and how we have to reread him today? What further theories may be helpful? How a Polanyian and other analysis of capitalism come together? And therefore, we are very happy to have all these wonderful contributions of colleagues who are experts in the research on Karl Polanyi or discovering his work, who are working about the ecological, economic, political, social, and cultural development, who are doing research in the global north, in the global south, in the east, and in the west. And the third step we have to make, and I can make it now easy, who could be better to introduce in Karl Polanyi today? It's the title of the opening speech, than Michael Bolroy. Everybody here knows Michael Bolroy, but for formal reasons I will introduce him. Michael Bolroy is a global sociologist in its best sense. Case studies in Zambia, Russia, and USA let him do ethnographic work on the shop floor. His book, Manufacturing Consent, has stimulated the international debate in the sociology of work. He is a protagonist of public and global sociology, a term and concept brought into discussion by him as president of the American Sociological Association in 2002 to 2004, and the International Sociological Association in 2010 to 2014. He is the editor of Current Sociology Monograph, bringing together public sociologists from around the world, and he is editing the ISA magazine Global Dialogue, published in 17 languages all around the world. Michael Bolroy is an expert of the research on Karl Polanyi, and he is an expert of the research on contemporary capitalisms, and I'm very honored and delighted that he will address the conference with his opening speech, Karl Bonanno, today. Thank you very much for coming, Michael.
Socialist Hungary. Anyway, I will not talk about that, but I just like to acknowledge that this is a wonderful place to be having a conference on Karl Polanyi. And I was very, Andreas, where's Andreas gone? There you are. I mean, it's amazing. He's in the University of Economics and Business in Vienna, and he is defending Polanyi. Yes, well, I'll say a little bit more about economists and Karl Polanyi in a few minutes, but I'm really delighted that in Austria we have these heterodox economists who are sort of combating the orthodoxy. Well, I hope I'm not offending anybody here. Probably not. right, so... Yes, it's a real honor to be here because, as Brigitte said, this is an international conference. This is Polanyi's ideas being explored in different parts of the world, and this is really very, very exciting. I am actually going to be a bit braver than Brigitte. I am actually going to acknowledge in the audience here people who I think will do a better job of giving this keynote address than myself. People who are really actually have been for a long time experts in the writings of Carl Polanyi. And I must start obviously with Carrie Polanyi-Levitt, who lived with Carl Polanyi for many years, and so very familiar with him. And we're going to have, I hope, a wonderful conversation on Thursday about his life. And then recognize Beverly Silver, Karen Fisher, Bob Jessop, Klaus Dore, Maria Mocantanato, yeah, you're there, right, Gareth Dale, who I've never met, and David Woodruff, who I met quite frequently in Berkeley. So these are just the people I know there must be many other experts on Carl Polanyi here, not necessarily from the English-speaking world, and I look forward to hearing and learning from the many wonderful panels, presentations of the next few days. Yes, I should also like to mention, you may not know that Zygmunt Bauman died yesterday or the day before, at the age of 92, and he was, in my view, even if he did not know it, but I think he did, was very influenced by Carl Polanyi, much of his writings. I was always wanting to write a paper on Bauman and Polanyi because they have a very interesting, have a very interesting convergence. And anyway, he is was a wonderful, if you will, public sociologist, and has inspired many people over the last three decades. And also, like Carl Polanyi, had an extraordinary, fascinating history. So I think it's appropriate that we recognize his contributions. I should also like to say, as was really very apparent last night, it was a wonderful public sociology event in the, what do you call it, the Knowledge Tower. Right, which is again a tribute to the Linz that you are able to bring lay population, lay publics together with academics to discuss very, very pressing issues. National populism was the agenda last night. And it was a very interesting one. I followed because it was not always easy for me to follow. But nevertheless, it was clear that this was a very important discussion that was taking place. And from the questions, it was clear too. Yes. So the point is, of course, is that we are having this conference on Carl Polanyi at a very, very appropriate time in history. I think the world is crying out for Polanyi-esque analyses of the world of contemporary capitalism, as Brigitte said in her introduction. And so I would like to say a few words about this for the next 40 minutes. So I'm going to give you my sort of reading vision of Carl Polanyi and his writings, and I hope I will upset a number of you, I think that his writings are of not only great importance, but great brilliance, and I go back repeatedly, as I will indicate, to his writings, and I have different readings for every decade. So, let me begin. Right, let's see if this works. Oh, look at that. Okay. I tend to walk around. I hope you won't mind. If you're sitting on the front, you may get a bit dizzy. Do I need a mic?
Yeah, all right. Let me select.
Okay. So, engaging Carl Polanyi. I think there are four ways. There are four ways to engage Polanyi. Carl Polanyi. The first way is to dismiss Carl Polanyi. And we were having a conversation, I've forgotten who it was with, but you know, how many economists, orthodox types, how many economists even know about Carl Polanyi? Interesting question. And Carrie is already telling me, not many. So he is talking about the economy, he's talking about markets, but he is not a friend of neoclassical, neoliberal economic analysis. However, we have an exception in Vienna where the economists are broken up into two groups, the heterodox and the orthodox. And actually, it's fascinating because the heterodox economists are on the top floor and the orthodox are on the bottom floor. So this suggests a relationship of domination in Vienna. Right, Andreas? So, but anyway, yes, there are people who don't ignore Polanyi, those who dismiss it. I must confess, in my early years, I remember, I think it must have been about 1978 or 1979, I taught a course, which I regretted forevermore, with a fellow called, a very famous sociologist in my university, called Neil Smelser. Some of you of my generation may have heard of this gentleman. He wrote a very interesting book on Industrial Revolution. The course was on the Industrial Revolution, and we did read Karl Polanyi, and we both agreed, I'm embarrassed to say, that this guy's really problematic, this fellow Karl Polanyi. He has an analysis of all the pathologies of Industrial Revolution, marketization. But then he's got this sort of functionalist thing called society, undefined, unclear, but somehow always reacts back and keeps things in equilibrium. That's how we sort of saw it at the time, but this was a real functionalist reading, and we saw no mechanisms at the time through which society would actually, in a sense, become what we now call the counter-movement. Anyway, that was my first examination of Karl Polanyi. I had examined him before, I suppose, when I had been studying migrant labor in California and South Africa, and I'd drawn on a part of Karl Polanyi that Carrie doesn't even want to talk about, the part on Spienamland. Now, a third of the book is about Spienamland system. This is basically a system that Polanyi talks about, the ways in which workers in the rural areas of England, or certain parts of the rural areas of England, they basically get extra aid to bring up their subsistence wage to a living wage, and basically it's a subsidy for the employers, the agrarian classes that employ workers, and it basically locks workers into the rural areas, and from Polanyi's point of view, prevents the development of a national labour market. And I use those ideas of the ways in which labour gets subsidised in my studies of migrant labour in South Africa and California. But anyway, the point is that that was not dismissing Polanyi, that was actually, I'll talk about it in a minute. It's a problem with PowerPoint, you have to follow it. But I'll talk about in a minute the way one uses Polanyi. The opposite of dismissing is to canonize Polanyi. It's interesting that there are very few people who say that Polanyi had the last word on anything. He has not been canonized in the way that Karl Marx has been canonized. But you know, there are people in the world who say what Marx said must be true. I think there are very few people who say that what Karl Polanyi writes must be true. He writes in a way that you never really know what he's actually saying sometimes, too. So it's really, there's a certain ambiguity and ambivalence and undevelopedness about many of his ideas that has made his work so important and generated such a proliferation in the last 50 years of writings about contemporary capitalism. And ambiguities and contradictions are the fuel of good theorizing. You know, the great thing is that the great theorists have great contradictions, and I think there are some great contradictions in Polanyi. So he's not somebody who's going to be canonized, he's not going to be an ideology of the party state, he is somebody who has a profound insight into the world, but often of an ambiguous and interesting way so that we can all debate them. Yes, so then the third way is to borrow from Polanyi. You know, it's like going into the supermarket. You know, you take off the shelf whatever you want and put it in your pocket, and sometimes you pay and sometimes you don't. Sometimes you recognize your debt, sometimes you don't recognize your debt to Polanyi. And I've been guilty of that. I told you about my migrant labor studies, state socialism in Hungary. One of the most imaginative appropriations of Polanyi's writings done by a very famous Hungarian sociologist by the name of Ivan Seleni. Some of you may know of him. And he had the brilliant idea, taking ideas from Polanyi, that under state socialism, the state administered economy will be effective if and only if there is a supplemental market economy. That the gaps in the administered planned economy can be filled by a rudimentary embryonic market sector. So in the case of housing, which he studied, the idea was that yes, there's state-administered housing, and actually it is the party cadre, technicians, white-collar workers who got the housing, not the working class. The working class began to build their own housing because the state started to generate a market in glass, in bricks, in wood, and made it possible for the working class to actually build their own housing. And he shows how market and state actually work very well together in state socialism. Just under advanced capitalism, markets need states to fill the functional gaps of the market. And that is a very sort of an inspired appropriation of Polanyi, because of course Polanyi too saw this relationship between market and society as potentially one of tension and interdependence. Yes, and in my own work in Hungary, I also showed, for example, in socialist factories that really functioned effectively, that you had actually internal labor markets, that again, the administered hierarchy of the socialist, state socialist economy in Hungary required a sort of adaptive market functioning within the factory, forms of inside contracting, as it was called in the literature. Anyway, so that's Hungary. Then I had and David Woodruff knows this all much better than I was his student then, and, well, he was I was a faculty person and he was officially a student, but actually, as often happens, the relationship was inverted. But anyway, the story in Russia, you know, I was there stuck in Russia in the 1990s. I don't know how many of you were there in the 1990s, but this was the post-Soviet Russia. The decline of the economy was as rapid as the advance of the Chinese economy at the time. We hadn't seen in peacetime such a rapid descent of an economy that was, in a sense, deindustrializing. So what I was observing in the 1990s, I was up there in near the Arctic Circle, a place called Syktyvkar, wondering how to be a factory worker when there are no factories, because the factories were disappearing. And it was also unethical for me to be working in the factories because there were so few jobs. And those who had jobs may or may not get paid. And if they got paid, they might be paid in flour or in vodka. I mean, this was a sort of economy I had never seen before. And what was the energy in this economy, what was driving it, was not production, accumulation. In fact, there was what I call primitive disaccumulation. What was actually driving it was the market exchange. You see, in Russia, post-Soviet Russia, there were those who thought, borrowing ideas from the West, now, the only way to make a market transition is to do it rapidly. Big Bang Theory. Shock therapy. You must do it quickly, otherwise those ex-communists will actually impede that transition. So they were there to, basically the strategy from above was to destroy everything associated with the Soviet economy. Quite the opposite of what was happening in China, where the party state was nurturing the development of the market. And the Chinese are red pill land. The trouble is that the marketeers in Russia were actually not devotees of Polanyi. They were devotees of this sort of revolutionary transition to the market economy. They inherited, the ideas of Lenin. It was like a Bolshevik transition to capitalism. At one point it was the Chatalin plan. We're going to make the transition from the socialist economy to capitalism. 500 days. Imagine that. Well, they tried, and the result of this marketization was not revolution, it was not evolution, as the institutionalist economists had advocated, but it's what I call involution. That there was indeed what I call not a great transformation, but a great involution. That the market expansion was eating up the economy, was eating up the process of accumulation. And what was happening? Labor was being displaced. Land was being sort of reoccupied in a subsistence way. Collective farms were becoming credit centers, and peasants were really reoccupying the land. And money, and you can read David Woodruff's book on this, is the end of money at that time. It was the movement from a ruble economy to a barter economy. It was a retreat into a pre-capitalist world. And this, when I was reading Polanyi, I was looking for the counter-movement. And what was I seeing? This withdrawal, this great involution. Well, it didn't last so long. It lasts probably until Putin arrived. The economy can only go down so far before it begins to creep up again. But anyway, I was seeing and looking at the ways in which one might have a Polanyi-esque interpretation of what was going on, focusing on what he would call fictitious commodities, land, labor, and money. So that was my attempt to understand what was happening in Russia in the 1990s. And let me talk about my last sort of application, which was now 5 years ago, when I was traveling around the world a great deal, when I was, as Brigitte said, I was then president of the International Sociological Association, 2010 to 2014 and 2011. Remember, movement of the streets, Occupy, all over the world, Occupy movements. Right next to me, I live in Oakland, California, a very interesting militant Occupy movement. Obviously starts in New York, but you know, everywhere I go, whether it's Hong Kong, whether it's Sao Paulo, Chile, wherever I went, there was an Occupy movement. Then there was the Indignados, Southern Europe. Then there was the Arab Spring, 2011, 2012. You know, Brazil had its moments in 2013. Then there was the Turkish Gezi Park, Taksim Square. I don't know, it was 2013, I think. I mean, we were all saying, this is interesting. This is the Polanyian response. Well, I was arguing the Polanyian response to marketization. And I began imagining and interpreting these social movements in terms of the experience of the market, the experience of the commodification of land, money, and labor, And then, what happens, right? A few years later, we already begin to see right-wing movements. I think rather they were sort of, they were in the background in some places. But basically, I myself, particularly guilty, but others too, I really saw these progressive movements that sought to actually circumvent liberal democracy everywhere. And I mustn't forget Greece, excuse me. These movements, what they shared was actually a rejection of parliamentary democracy, liberal democracy, and argued for horizontalism, argued for direct democracy, and there were visions of alternative direct forms of participatory democracy. And now we're faced, as we heard last night and we will hear in this conference, of so many right-wing movements, different forms of right-wing movements. We were talking largely last night, or the panelists were, of Europe. But just think what's been happening in the Arab Spring world. Just think of what's been happening. Let's leave Libya aside. But just think what's been happening in the heartland of Arab Spring, Egypt. Just think of Tahrir Square in 2011, the January 25th revolution, and think now. Basically, over time, over these 3-4 years, there's been a reassertion of military rule under el-Sisi, which is actually, according to observers, scholars, more authoritarian than the regime under Mubarak. And one can see similar movements. One thinks, for example, of Brazil. One can think of places in Europe. I don't know where you're going to put Greece these days. But you know that all the optimism of Syriza has evaporated over time. And one can think of movements, just think of the Philippines today. We had a Filipino, But you didn't mention Duterte last night. But you could have, well, of course, all right. Well, anyway, Duterte is the prototype almost of a contemporary fascist. I mean, you know, it's an interesting comparison, Trump and Duterte. But there you have somebody who was elected, populist elected, who first acts are actually of a violent character against those drug pushers. So anyway, again, there is has authoritarianism with sort of absorbed also left-wing parts of the left in the Philippines. Yeah, what we are seeing is this across the world, I want to emphasize across the world, this movement to the right. And of course, you can only think about Polanyi. Well, you can think about other things too. But Polanyi, sort of, his concern was the rise of fascism in response to marketization. All right. That is my sort of half my talk to indicate the different borrowings that at least I have been engaged in vis-a-vis Polanyi, and of course there have been many, many others of a very different and variegated character. So that's borrowing from Polanyi. That's going into the supermarket and borrowing his ideas, taking them off the shelf. And then I want to talk the rest of my time about reconstructing Polanyi. Now, of course, the people who canonize Polanyi are really not going to be enthusiastic about reconstructing it. But the point of reconstruction is to take, to try and imagine and understand and interpret Polanyi's writings as a whole and to see how we might reconstruct the whole with regard to the challenges of the present. And I've got a two-part argument, but let me first talk about two types of reconstruction of Polanyi. Okay, the first is what I call Polanyi after Marxism. This is the Polanyi reconstruction that says, communism is gone, Marxism went with it, and therefore there's no real vision of an alternative to capitalism. The best we can do is regulate capitalism in a perhaps social democratic fashion. And this is the story that, if I may suggest, Fred Block and Peggy Summers present, the always embedded market. This is an idea, of course, that is very present in Polanyi, the idea that markets need social supports, they need to be embedded, and they need to be also politically regulated. I don't think that's so original to Polanyi. Durkheim said it all before. But anyway, that is definitely in Polanyi. And I think it's now the basis of what I call economic sociology, which arose in the, well, I suppose economic sociology arose in the 1980s and 1990s as a response to Marxism that had made some inroads into sociology around questions of political economy and the organization of work and the labor process. There is a turn into this Polanyi analysis of markets and their conditions of existence, the critique of the economists for failing to understand the social and political preconditions of the market. And of course, this sort of argument became very important in those who were talking about the transition from state socialism to the market, to a capitalist economy, because they argued with Polanyi that you can't have a market road to market capitalism. You can't just jump in to the market economy by destroying the state socialist administered economy. But you need to have these supports. As I said before, the Chinese seem to have recognized this, but not those who were directing the transformation in Russia. Anyway, that argument is one way of reconstructing Polanyi, is this looking at Polanyi as the pioneer prophet of the always embedded economy. Now, I'm more interested in a more dynamic view or dynamic reconstruction of Polanyi. This is Marxism after Polanyi. That yes, Marxism lives on after the collapse of the Soviet Union, after the sort of market transition to state capitalism in China. But Marxism lives on, in fact, is liberated by the dissolution of the Soviet Union. So Marxism, Marxism after Polanyi is the argument that an engagement with Polanyi can actually reinvigorate Marxism, and actually Marxism can reinvigorate Polanyi. Yes, so I tried, one effort of mine was to talk about a sociological Marxism. I'm a sociological chauvinist, so I'm always trying to defend sociology, and I took Polanyi as a very important comrade in actually giving new energy of a Marxist character to sociology. But what I did was actually to bring Polanyi into a partnership with a fellow called Antonio Gramsci, another Marxist, and where Polanyi talks about the relationship between market and society, Gramsci talks about the relationship between state and society, and I believe that is really missing in Polanyi, a careful examination of the relation between state and society. In fact, it often reduces state to society. That's one of the problems in Polanyi's writings. He needs a dose of Gramsci. So that is what I try to do in my work on sociological Marxism. But I want today to talk about a Marxism after Polanyi, or a Marxist interpretation of Polanyi by centering the market. Now, Marx, when we read the three volumes of Capital, can we still read the three volumes of Capital? Klaus clearly does, yes. So, centering the market. So Marx, well, what does Marx have to say about the market? Market for Marx as well, it's the orchestration of the competition among capitalists. It's the ways in which capitalists are interdependent with one another. It can lead to, markets can lead to the degradation of work. Markets for Marx, when you read the opening pages of volume one of Capital, it's all about fetishism of commodities. It's the ways in which markets obscure the reality of capitalism, which is focused on production. But I want to sort of suggest there are two ways in which Polanyi actually uses the market in a way that was not developed by Marx, first as a response to crisis. The expansion of the market post-1970s was in a sense a response to both a profitability crisis and an overproduction crisis in the development of capitalism. So markets are actually a response to crisis. And second, markets themselves develop a specific experience. And that's what I'll talk quite a bit about when I talk about fictitious commodities. He has these three factors of production, land, labor, and money. And it is the experience for Polanyi of their commodification, their unregulated commodification, that gives rise to potential degradations on the one side and social movements on the other. So, all right. So that's what I'm going to explore is this last responses to crisis and experience. That's what the rest of my talk will be about. Well, we've got about 10 minutes. Is that okay? No, no way. No, everybody will be asleep. No, no. Okay. Look. Everybody makes the one comment about Polanyi. This guy thought, and I could have given you a quote, but I won't. This guy Polanyi thought that, humanity would never be so crazy as to ever indulge in an experiment of marketization again. Market fundamentalism is not something that humanity, after I've written this book and show what are the catastrophic consequences of marketization, nobody's going to ever do it again. But this way he formulated it suggests that he saw, as indeed Beverly Silver and Giovanni Arrighi have written in a great article in Politics and Society, that basically Polanyi saw the origins of marketization as being in the heads, in the thoughts, the dreams, the discourse of economists of the 19th century. That they were the ones who were actually responsible for marketization. And so he thought, insofar as it comes from the ideological ideas, so we will never do it again. This, in my view, is a fundamental error. I think he lost sight of Marxism. In many ways, the Great Transformation was a polemic against Marxism, but particularly the Marxism of the laws of development of capitalism, the idea that there is a teleology to capitalism, the rise and the fall of capitalism, and that you go from, I don't know, the ancient mode of production to the feudal mode of production to the capitalist mode of production to communism and Bob's your uncle. That this whole historical trajectory is fabricated. Fake news, they call it these days in America. So, it's an imaginary teleology. Polanyi would have nothing to do with it. But he threw the baby out with the bathwater, because he didn't have a theory of capitalist development, of capitalist accumulation. And that he desperately needs, because I believe a theory of capitalist accumulation, the way that capitalism generates crises, responds to those crises, the work, for example, of Klaus Dore and his colleagues from Yale, that this a theory of capitalism is essential to understanding where markets come from, and that marketization is indeed a consequence of the dynamics of capitalism. It is not, yes, economists are there justifying it, legitimating it, but it doesn't just come from their heads. It is capitalism that drives flexibility on labor, that drives finance capital and the rise of debt, that drives the commodification of land. So, yes, we have to talk about the dynamics of capitalism. So I'm rejecting Polanyi's optimism and talking about how the crisis of capitalism would generate marketization. Now, if there is another cycle of marketization after the one that Polanyi saw, which he saw beginning at the end of the 18th century, going through the 19th century, and ending up in the 1930s with a counter-movement, state regulation, for him, Stalinism, for him, the New Deal, and one could add social democracy. If one then recognizes that there is not, that there is another wave of marketization after he had finished writing in 1944, then perhaps there were more than one wave before 1944. And I would suggest there are at least two that can be discerned from within his own writings. That there is a first wave of marketization in the early 19th century, and a counter-movement which revolves around, as he formulates it, labor struggles, reduction of the length of the working day, the factory acts, Owenism, cooperatives, trade unions, and even on the continent of Europe, political parties. That's the one. Then there is a second wave that one could argue emerges after World War I and ends up not with local struggles, or not only with local struggles, but now with state interventions, very much connected to the ways in which, for Polanyi, the gold standard sort of rigidified economies, so people broke with the gold standard in the pursuit of a more regulated economy. So I would suggest there are three ways of marketization. Now, the scale of these counter-movements, once we recognize there are more than one, I would say the first wave, the counter-movement had a local character, rising to the state. The second had a state-centered character. And the third, I would argue today, a counter-movement today, and we're still in this wave of marketization, the counter-movement today has to be, though it may not actually be, has to be, if we are going to save the world, has to be of a global character. We have to regulate finance capital globally. We have to organize regulation of the environment globally. And with the displacement of so much labor, with migration being such a central aspect of the labor market today, we have to organize the regulation, protection of labor also globally. And the question, of course, is whether in fact that will happen. What it means is that Polanyi has to also recognize, and I don't think he does adequately, a relationship between state and society, or state and I call civil society. And that's why I originally had introduced the work of Gramsci, which focuses on the relation between state and society. So, but what I want to really emphasize here is that there is no inevitability of the counter-movement. You know, you read Polanyi and he seems to argue that society is getting degraded, distorted, pathologized, destroyed, and it's going to react back. It's going to, in a sense, protect itself from the markets. He has a very crude, we would say, a sociologist, vision of social movements and how they work. Very Durkheimian. So you push the market far enough, there's going to be a reaction. Action and reaction. But there is not a lot of empirical evidence, in my view, to support that theory of social movements. Yes, there may have been a counter-movement in the 19th century. Yes, there may have been a counter-movement in the 20th century. But that doesn't imply there's going to be a counter-movement today. No. In fact, it's very difficult to imagine how this global, if I'm correct, global counter-movement can actually be organized. So many of the reactions to the market, whether of the left or the right, are still of a national character, even if they are connected globally, they do not have a global scale. They are orchestrated nationally. which was very clear last night, only talking about Europe, how different the countries are in the way that they respond to marketization. Yes. So that's my picture. Now, unlike Beverly Silver, I have no data. I have just got Carl Polanyi. But this is my rereading of Carl Polanyi, and it's cyclical form, and arguing that marketization starting 1795 and with the Spielman system and then its gradual dissolution. And I don't know why, but 1834 is the actual, for Polanyi, the turning point. This is the magical moment when there is a pure market, national market. Oh, you've got one over there. And pure national market in England. So that's the tip. And then I argue, reading Polanyi, there is some sort of beginnings of a counter movement. The factory acts, the factory movement, the Owenism, Chartism, and he's very much riveted, of course, to England. And then World War I is the moment of, on the one hand, the rise of the struggles against the market, and then the renewal of the market after World War I. And then we get 1933, the abolition of the gold standard, and then we now get the counter-movement, World War II, and then eventually that counter-movement turns into the crisis of 1973, the oil crisis, and from then on we have an increase in marketization, and 1989 is a moment of resurgence in a sense of the market, when it says, you know, essentially when the Soviet Union basically declares that the only way forward is a capitalist road, and in a sense, in a different way, in a Polanyi way, China is similar. That's 1989 or 1991, and then of course there is the crisis of 2008. But the market moves on, even though there are moments of regulation in that period. That we, what's the most extraordinary, interesting thing? We're expecting some of us were expecting some sort of new deal, but no. There is markets move on, and they continue to move on. And the question is, that's why it's dotted, whether there will be a counter movement. And I'm suggesting that the counter movement in the first phase is local, second, nation state, third, global, and we have to insert a global context. And so I just appropriated Giovanni Arrighi and Beverly Silver's sort of distinctions between colonialism, somewhat imperialism, and then of course they very optimistically, say that China, or pessimistically, I don't know what, that China will be the next hegemon. And come on, are you dropping that?
No, that's not it. It's a misreading.
Excuse me.
About a Thursday night.
Okay. What do you think?
I'll talk about it Thursday night. I'm getting a confirmation that it's misreading.
Okay. All right. Well, at least I put question marks after China. All right. Okay. Very good. But anyway, it isn't. I'm not quite sure how to conceptualize the global in the contemporary period. And all right. So fine. Good. So that's the story here. Now the last part of what I want to say is really all about fictitious commodities. Because I don't think we can talk about this counter-movement, or even the movement of marketization, without talking about what it is that is being marketized, what it is that's being commodified, namely, for Polanyi, labor, land, and money. Now, he does not have a lot to say about these fictitious commodities, but it is very significant that many of the commentators on Polanyi really do focus on the idea of fictitious commodity. Wolfgang Sprint talks about it, and Nancy Fraser talks about it. If they two talk about it, then presumably, you know, that's part and parcel of the discourse these days. So fictitious commodity is a very important idea. What is a fictitious commodity? Good question. Well, Nancy Fraser distinguishes, I think rightly so, between what she calls an ontological meaning and a structural meaning. The ontological meaning is that there are certain things, labor, money, and land, that were never intended to be commodified. That they, labor, money, and land, were entities that somehow would be not labor, land, and money anymore if they were commodified. As I said, it's a philosophical argument, whether they were, who said something is intended or not intended to be something. Much better is a structural notion. And I interpret the structural notion of a fictitious commodity is the idea that through the exchange process, the unregulated exchange process, the use value of that entity is lost. That as labor becomes commodified in an unregulated manner, it becomes ever more precarious. As land is commodified, whether it be through appropriation in urban areas, whether it be subject to genetic crops, genetic engineering, when land is commodified, it involves a dispossession of those who were originally on the land. That the commodification of land is endangering for Polanyi the very survival of humanity that is so intrinsically connected to production on the land of a non-commodified character. And of course we should extend this to air, to extend it to water, so we talk about the commodification of nature, as he does in these examples. And then there is the commodification of money, and that we see in the idea of money being made from money. That money was intended to be a medium of exchange, a way of measuring value, but it becomes a source of profit, and much of that profit often revolves around debt. So this is how I see it. Here's Marx. Production, exploitation. Polanyi, marketization, commodification. Polanyi says, okay, there are these three fictitious commodities that should not be commodified, that when they are commodified, they lose their use value. Commodified in an unregulated way, they lose their use value. Now, what he does not emphasize enough, in my view, is the violence that is involved in actually creating a commodity. Whether it's labor, land, or money, there is violence involved, often state violence, in creating a commodity, the process of disembedding. Look, when I want to sell my lung, it has to be disembedded from my body. It's a violent process. And that is something that he did not emphasize enough, that we see all around us, the violent disembedding, creating commodities thereby. And as a result of the commodification, we get labor that is in a precarious state, we get land that is dispossessed, and we get the rising of debt, whether it be individual, organizational, or whether it be national, or regional. So we get, these are the sort of pathologies that go along with unregulated commodification. And then we get something that I guess I've invented that may or may not stand up to scholarly investigation or examination, that it's not just a problem of something being commodified, it is actually a problem that the market actually expels things, that labor becomes unemployed, that's a real problem. That land becomes wasteland because of the way that we treat it. And debt, as we learnt in post-Soviet Russia, can actually lead to people exiting the money economy, engaging in barter. So I think there are processes of ex-commodification that involve violence too. It's not just commodification. What's even worse is ex-commodification. People desperately want to be able to sell their labor power, but are not able to do so. Yeah. All right. Now, there is this thing called knowledge. Actually, Bob Jessop wrote about this. From the famous Paul Polanyi conference in Istanbul. Phew. Okay. Yeah. So I think that we have to think of knowledge as itself something that is commodified increasingly. And the place where it's most visible is the university. Yeah. That actually we are having in the university to now sell our knowledge. It's a pity the rector and the dean are not here. I don't know. It's very strange. The rector and the dean, both sick on the time of the Carl Polanyi Well, yeah, I don't know. I mean, administrations these days are under a lot of hot water. They're under a lot of attack at where I come from. Whoa, we just got rid of our chancellor. Anyway, no, that's beside the point. No, it's not beside the point, actually. It is because the university is subject increasingly to hard budget constraints that it has had to sell its knowledge, and to sell the dissemination of this knowledge. Selling the dissemination of this knowledge is actually charging you people fees. But in Austria, that's taboo. You can't, in style, apparently, politically, so far, well, we'll see what the next political coalition in this country will be, but at the moment, you can't charge fees. Therefore, the university, you must come from a business school. Yeah. Fees are
when you're studying too long, or when you come from third, non-EU country, then you pay.
Oh, yeah, those foreigners. They pay. They pay. We survive on out-of-state students. They have to pay 33,000, whereas the California students only pay 13. And we got into real trouble because 30% of our students, 30% of our students are out of state. And then, of course, the people in California go up in arms and say, "Oh, my son got straight A's. He's the most brilliant student in the class. He can't get into Berkeley. Why? Because of all those foreign students." And they say, "This is the University of California. It should be for the people in California." Huge problem. And so then the president says, "Well, this is a political problem. Well, all the new campuses are now going to have to increase enrollments. 5,000 this year, 5,000 next year. It's a bloody disaster. We have no space, no resources to actually accept those students. It means the degradation of higher education. But there are many ways in which you can actually begin to collect money. You go to your alumni, if you're lucky. Or you get federal grants, though that actually turns out to be a very costly business. Or you get investment from pharmaceutical companies. Or you have every building named after a bank.
Or lecture rooms.
Or lecture rooms even. Yes.
Well, I suppose it's true the rector's not here.
Yeah. But anyway, the point is that universities in one way or another, some more advanced than others, all over the world, are having to actually sell either knowledge itself or the dissemination of knowledge to students. And that means a process of dispossession. We are losing control of our university because we are having to produce knowledge that will actually bring in money. And I don't have to tell this audience that this is very, very urgent issue. So that is my story, and I could go on and on about this, but that is my thought about the commodification of knowledge. Of course, we could also talk about the ways in which you might say the commodification of knowledge, by perhaps better information, has led to the possibility of a counter-movement in the form, I don't know, of social media. the internet is accessible to all, as indeed knowledge was in the old days. You know, knowledge produced in the university was public knowledge, but increasingly it's becoming privatized, and of course the internet is becoming the terrain of an intense struggle as to who and how it will be controlled. Okay, so I'm suggesting here that knowledge is the fourth fictitious commodity, and what is the, I'm not sure, what is the corresponding pathology? I've called it information, it's not really good, it doesn't quite capture, the sorts of pathologies that happen when knowledge is commodified. Certainly, information is part of it. But, and then of course there is the question of what it means to talk about ex-commodification, in the sense of the waste in knowledge, the knowledge that is produced that is useless. Of course, there is quite a bit of that.
Fake news, yes.
Uh-huh. But anyway, what I want to suggest, if you accept that, or if, even if you don't accept that, one thing that we have to talk about is the articulation of these fictitious commodities. You know, in the old days, Marxists used to talk about the articulation of modes of production. Well, now we have to talk about, in my view, the articulation of modes of commodification of fictitious commodities. So we have to talk about, because of course when you produce knowledge, it also has an effect on the ways in which labor is organized, the ways in which money is commodified, and the way that land is being commodified. GE crops, are a good example of the way knowledge, commodification of knowledge and the commodification of land go hand in hand. So there I believe there's a big research project. What is the, how do we understand the articulation of the relations between these fictitious commodities? Now, okay, well Marx said exploitation leads to class struggle. Yeah, well, that's tricky. And there were moments in history where that obviously took place. 19th century might be a good example where exploitation led to class struggle. Though Polanyi argued that actually the struggles of the 19th century were the result of the commodification, the buying and selling of labor power in an unregulated fashion, which led to struggles, the experience of unregulated commodification rather than exploitation. And he has an argument in the book based on some empirical analysis. Though, of course, most people would say, yes, well, perhaps it's both. You can always have both. But I want to draw a real distinction. And, of course, I've argued in my other work that actually exploitation is invisible. Nobody knows one, you know, really experiences exploitation. You experience work with effort and deprivation, but not experience exploitation. But you might say, the question is this. Is it, in the present world, the increasing inequality between capital and labor, which is, might be argued, non-orthodox Marxist way, might be argued as a reflection of exploitation. Is it that increasing inequality, polarization, that is driving struggles, or is it the relationship to commodification, marketization? Of course, you know, this commodification process will look very different in different parts of the world. Oh, okay, so there's class struggle, the response to exploitation, and counter-movement is a response to marketization, which leads to commodification and ex-commodification. That is the argument. And of course, if we're thinking about just social movements on the ground, there is no reason to believe, in and of itself, that people experiencing these different forms of commodification, ex-commodification, have any necessary common interests that has to be, in a sense, elaborated, constituted, that common interest. So, all right, I think that the struggles of the Marxist character are strongly around processes of inclusion. But basically, labor struggles are struggles that depend upon capitalists' dependence upon labor. They're basically Marxist think that it is labor because it is included, it is therefore exploited, it is part of the production process, that it begins to understand and recognize a vision of an alternative to capitalism and engages in struggle. It is included in capitalism as an exploited class. And the point about many of these commodifications and ex-commodifications is they're a process of exclusion. That what is happening is that people are being pushed out of production, pushed out of the, off the land, pushed out of the money economy. It is a process of exclusion. And my wager is that that these movements of exclusion, and here we associate with I would associate with the writings of Frantz Fanon. I don't know if you read this in Austria, but in the United States, in certain quarters, it's a popular, Frantz Fanon's a popular figure, but perhaps not so much the wretched of the earth, but black skin and white masks. But nevertheless, Fanon is associated with the so-called revolutionary struggles of the excluded, very much at odds with the Marxian idea of being struggles of the included. For Fanon, the working class in colonial and post-colonial countries is a pampered labor aristocracy that has not an interest in revolution. But it is the peasantry, the excluded, that are the revolutionary class. So that's an interesting question as to whether the movements of exclusion are coming to dominate the movements around the world, because after all, the struggles of the working class are, as we know, dampened because, in fact, more and more are being excluded from work, because actually employment in many countries, in all countries, in the wage labor sector, stable employment with trade union recognition, woo, that is becoming a more prerogative of a minority concerned to protect itself. Yeah. All right. So, conclusion. Well, that's my picture. I think these waves have to be interpreted. Well, the counter movements to the waves, but the waves too, the waves of marketization, have to be interpreted in terms of the articulation of these fictitious commodities. And labor dominates, I would argue, in the first wave, money and labor, the second, and nature plus labor and money, the third. But that's very tendentious. But basically, all I want to say is that we have to think about these waves in terms of the articulation of these modes of production. And now we have a conclusion. So, first of all, everything that I said has to be examined empirically, of course. I shouldn't be doing that. I'm a bit old to do that. To start doing real serious anthropological work. But anyway, history obviously is important, whether in fact these waves really make sense. And of course there is a history of the study of waves in Marxism, Kondratiev waves, and so on and so forth. But these are slightly different. They sometimes overlap with Kondratiev. But more important, not just as important, is geography. I mean, do these waves look the same in different parts of the world? Can you actually carry a Polanyian vision, this one or others, to other parts of the world? Which is so great about this conference, is that we're going to have to see whether, in fact, it works in the Philippines, in India, in Brazil, and so on and forth. So, yes, we have to take cognizance of geography. And of course, Polanyi had a very Eurocentric vision. Yes, he obviously was very much interested in what's happening in the United States and its peculiarity, but his analysis of South Africa is a really erroneous one historically. It's seen as the extreme form of unregulated marketization, where in fact that is probably not the case. All right, but anyway, history and geography are important. Then there is this issue. There are these fascinating articles that Polanyi writes in the 1920s and early 30s that are of a very Marxist tenor, very Marxist. And he there argues that capitalism and democracy are antithetical. So, and this is of course no Marxian argument. You know, when Marx was writing in 1848, 1851, he sort of ends by saying, you know, democracy, liberal democracy, electoral democracy. democracy is at odds with capitalism. The working class will become stronger and stronger. They will vote for the working class party, and out will go the capitalists. And so the capitalists either get rid of democracy, or we have socialism, fascism or socialism. And that, in a sense, is what Polanyi is arguing in the 1920s and 40s, fascism and socialism. Capitalism and liberal democracy can't go together. Well, they did go together, 30, 40 years. And the question is, whether that was just a little blip, whether in fact capitalism and democracy, as Polanyi saw in the 1930s, we are now seeing now, the disillusionment with democracy shown by both the left and the right, because democracy has been what? Hijacked by capitalism, particularly finance capital, in many countries, but in perhaps different ways, but across the world. So we're back with the Polanyi issue. Capitalism, fascism, or socialism. And you know, this whole period is 30 years, and this is what Piketty is saying, huh? Thomas Piketty in his book. He's saying that now we're going to move where there was a blip from the 1930s in advanced capitalist countries to 1970s. Inequality now is actually, in a sense, being restored to the level it was before that blip. We are returning to the 19th century. We're now in patrimonial capitalism. So I think we're living in a world where Polanyi's ideas are actually become ever more important. And we are faced with this issue of whether, yeah, Austria has still got electoral democracy, I know, but you have to look around the world. You know, as Marx says, de te fabula narratur, of you the future is told. Now the question, and Marx was talking to the Germans, saying that the Germans should take notice what's going on in England. You know, if you follow England, and you're going to follow England, that's the nature of capitalism, then you're going to have a revolution, and it's going to be so. You watch what's going on in England. So our question is, where should you be watching in Austria? Or should we all be watching in Austria and seeing the future as some sort of social? Oh, no, I don't believe it. So I think, you know, is it the United States? Is it the Philippines? Is it India? Well, we also have an interesting sort of response to marketization in India, which is not a sort of enclosed, isolationist position, but actually a more open, neoliberal. But anyway, I think that's an interesting question. What is obviously, which we will be debating, what will happen to the welfare state in Europe, Central Europe, Northern Europe. So there it is, fascism. If capitalism and democracy don't get on, then we're left with some fascism. And of course, we have to discuss what fascism might mean. No, Trump is not fascist. There's no party. Even Duterte, in that sense, there's no fascist party as yet. So, I mean, what do we mean by fascism? Yeah, good question. And then there is the issue I raised a minute or two ago, namely the struggles that we observe in the contemporary era. Are they struggles of the included or struggles of the excluded? Are they around exploitation or are they around processes of commodification and ex-commodification? And finally, I want to say that insofar as we are focused on struggles of a national character, whether of the left or of the right, whether of Sanders or of Trump, these are still conceived, represented, and organized at the national level. And that is like a counter-movement to the second wave of marketization. We're in the third wave. So these national projects are not really getting at a counter-movement of a global character. And I'm not saying that a counter-movement of a global character will be that pleasant. It could be global fascism, and it could be something like global socialism. But we have to think globally, which is, again, why this conference is such a wonderful event. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
you very much, Michael, for this inspiring opening speech. And I think that we have a lot of questions in the audience, and we have the luxury situation that we can take time. In the next days, it will be a little bit more difficult to have so much time for discussion, and I think we should use it. And I would like to open the floor for the common discussion of this input. So, okay, I try it. Let your arms. Okay. We start here on this side. You first, Greek from Philippines, and then Bob Jessup. Perhaps it's possible to mention your name and where you come from to better know each other. Please. That's okay. Yes, please.
Professor Phoebe Zoe Maria Sanchez from the Philippines. I've been asking last night the same thing, but I would like to emphasize that in the Philippines, we have foreign direct investments led economy. It's about 35% of the market. And our foreign debt is an outstanding $65 billion. And that would mean the next generations will be up to pay for this. That's quite a difficult situation. FDI is really something threatening for us. Local industries are dying, but foreign industries are quite strong. From service industries, for example, the call center agencies are actually flown to the Philippines because we can speak good English, and so we serve the world with the call center agents around us. And then if you look at the IRS, the industrial relations system, as I have mentioned last night, the transformation I saw is really the way it has become an informal industrial relations system. With flexibilization of labor. So we find all those schemes, 6-2 scheme, rotation basis, broken time basis, on-call, casualization, contractualization, all sorts. I can only say this is the way that capitalism has to resolve its crisis-driven path. And when we speak of Carl Polanyi, it could always be important that we look into the methodology. I guess he was combining both historical sociology in the Weberian context and rationalization, and at the same time, he is using capital, Marxist capital, or historical materialism, as a way to critique that large body of data from the experience of British enclosures up to the Spinham land, and even up to that point where Hope Finance was really killing the other aspects of the market. So I would like to say that when we look at the perspective of Polanyi, how do we look at capitalism today? I can see that what capitalism is doing is striving harder for resilience as a Kondratiev cycle is getting closer and closer. So here comes now capitalism on its feet to resolve the crisis, but the only strategy that it could stand on, or the strategy that it could make use of, is again the exploitation of labor, if not, again, to make better the way to make use of fictitious commodities. How do you do? And of course, if you mentioned about Duterte, the Duterte regime, if we have to know this one, because this is now very, controversial, I look at our government as, again, driven by this threat of FDIs. Drugs trade is rampant in the country, and the policy of the Duterte regime is really to shoot drug traders, be they Filipinos or non-Filipinos. And what I can describe the government is It's giving peace to the left, particularly the Communist Party of the Philippines. The rest of the puppet regimes, I say puppet because our regimes are all American puppet regimes. This is the only regime that you cannot go down to the street and say down to U.S. Duterte regime. In the previous regimes, march, people march and shout down with U.S. Marcos regime, down with Aquino regime, U.S. Aquino regime, down with the U.S. Arroyo regime, down with the U.S. Ramos regime, but at this point, you cannot go down the streets and say down with the U.S. Duterte regime. My reading of my government is that it is somehow a Huntingtonian thing, you know? There's a clash of civilization there. And how do you look at this?
We take the question of the yes.
Okay, thank you, Bob Jessup. I want to return to what I think is an unfortunate polarization of your discussion of Marx and Pahlavi. I think it's certainly true that after the collapse of the communist bloc, we were able to rediscover Marx, indeed to begin to read the volumes of Capital and other works. And I think then if we did that, we would find far more similarities between Marx and Pahlavi than you suggest. And the reason for that is when you presented Marx as production and exploitation, and you presented Pahlavi in terms of commodification. Even the opening chapter of Capital brings out what is historically specific about capitalism is the generalization of the commodity form to labor power. It acquires a price. Previously it didn't have a price in that sense. And Marx says in chapter 4 of Capital 1, there are two special commodities. They are labor power and money. And money is not a commodity either. It's a fictitious commodity. The distinction between money and money, money and capital. In volume 1, you don't get the discussion of land, but you do get the discussion of land in volume 3. And Marx himself was one of the first theorists of knowledge as a fictitious commodity. In the Communist Manifesto, you get his discussion of how the development of capitalism turns the doctor, the lawyer, the academic into paid hands rather than being independent professionals. In the 19th century, there's a distinction between industrial property and intellectual property, but they're both forms of intellectual property. And there's a very strong discussion of the consequences of the commodification of knowledge. Then if we think in terms of your table of the consequences, in terms of labor power, we have precarity, we have the relative surplus population, the absolute surplus population, the management by the state and capital of the size of the relative surplus population and how that feeds into exploitation. You get the discussion of land and dispossession, exactly what you're describing in terms of money. We get the discussion of the specificity of financial crises when there's a rush to gold as opposed to just trying to trade things and so forth. And we get a discussion in the Grundrisse or above all of the contradictions that come from starting to treat the general intellect, which is the general knowledge, as a source of private property and so forth. So I think if we look at Marx outside the context of what happens inside the labor process, what happens in production, you'll find very many similarities between Marx and Pahlavi. And I think on the other hand, there are many things that Pahlavi saw about these very same phenomena that would indeed then establish the basis for a very, very useful dialogue between a Pahlavian perspective in terms of counter-movement and resistance to those long waves. But I think it would be a pity if we decided that Pahlavi saw things that Marx didn't. I think they both saw them, but they saw them from a different perspective, from a different entry point. The question then, or the challenge then, is to put them into dialogue with each other. That was also a sort of advert for my part of the panel on which with Klaus Durer we're discussing Marx and Fabiani, but I thought in this opening plenary it was important to put in a word for Marx and not allow the case for Fabiani to go by default.
Good evening, Stefan Knast-Müller, I'm from Linz, from the university, and I'm struggling with two of your fictitious commodities in respect to the change that's coming, a bit to what you say, on labor. We have now the fourth industrial revolution, as it's called, Industry 4.0, and it means that we have full automatization, not just partial automatization like we have, but we're talking full automatization now. So the manual labor is basically pushed out of the whole process of construction, especially for manufacturing. So some say, okay, maybe we have in the knowledge sector, we'll create enough jobs, but even that's in question because we get algorithms that do a lot of work there, even in programming and so on. So I'm not exactly sure how this works with what you told about Polanyi's use of marketization. And the other thing is about money, because you said it's debt-driven. But Wolfgang Stützel wrote a book in 1978 about account and balance. So every time debt is created, it also creates wealth. So wealth and debt are always the same, always, because of our accounting rules. They're always the same. Even interest rates do not really change anything on that matter. So how works this with what you have presented?
Okay, I'll take the questions in order. The story of the Fabians is not an unusual story for the Global South. I think what you raise, and you raise a number of questions. One is, how do we think about globalization today? I mean, is it a form of imperialism, which is, in a sense, what you're implying? Or is it something different? And if we're going to believe there are three ways, then what is the specificity of it? The way you describe is very much of an imperialist character. So is that the story, the continuation of imperialism? Now, you described also, in very Polanyi-esque terms, the degradation of labor as a result of commodification. On the one hand, probably to some extent the expulsion of labor too. And whether particularly the call center is on the one hand now almost a labor aristocracy in the Philippines. But yes, so how would Polanyi look at all this? I think Duterte is really interesting because it is, as you say, it's an explicit program against U.S., let's call it imperialism. It's an explicit project to, in a sense, a nationalist project. And it is, in a sense, in my view, a second wave response to what is actually a third wave marketization. And that's a response we see in many places. And of course, that's one reason why he's been as successful as he has, including incorporating parts of the left in his own cabinet. I think it fits into the very Polanyi-esque vision that Polanyi had of the 1930s. And the question is then, of course, what is the specificity of this in the Global South today? But I have no more helpful response than that. But I think it fits very clearly into a Polanyi-esque understanding of a national response. Well, I would never argue with Bob Jessop's doctrinaire position on Marx. Yes, you can find everything in Marx.
And there's not a single thing that I can disagree with you about, in the sense that Marxists talk about all these things. I don't think it's fake news, it's bad, you know. And the question is, what is that? Is there any purpose in making the divide that I've made? I think you make me feel terrible, actually, because you remind me how actually in certain places Marx does actually see markets as a, particularly in the financial world, as a solution to crisis, temporary solution. So in the way that I was suggesting, this is a very polemic thing. I don't know if Marx, you say yes, Marx talks about in the volume 1 of Capital, where he talks about the commodity, absolutely, it is central. But why is he talking about the commodity? It's commodity fetishism. It hides what's going on in production. I still think that Marx essentially has a productivist notion, and exploitation is the secret of capitalism, and it's also the secret of struggle. And I want to argue that actually the experience of these fictitious commodities being commodified is actually the basis of social movements. I don't believe that's in Marx. That's the only, I think there's it is a exploitation labor driven, but that's all I got to say to you. But I probably should, well, I'm not, this is, I think there really is this exploitation commodification, even if in the end we bring them together, we're making this analytical distinction, posing the question of what actually is the relationship between the two. And I don't think it's clear. And I guess in my other writings I've pushed the Polanyi line. I think I would now have to bring back the, what is the relationship? That's your discussion between Marx and Polanyi. What is the relationship between exploitation and commodification? And I will leave it at that. I'm very impressed that you can figure out Marx talking about commodification of knowledge. He's very impressive.
I've written an article on it in the handbook of Marxist dictionary. But if I may just have one comment. I think there's a risk when looking at Marx, you only look at Das Kapital, which is focused on production and exploitation. If you were to look at the 18th Brumaire, if you were to look at the peasant wars in Germany, if you were to look at his work on the Civil War in the United States, on slave revolts and so forth, there you will find, in terms of concrete historical analyses, many of the social movements you think that Marx was not aware of. There is a difference in the logic of Marx's Kapital and Marx's historical conjunctural analyses, journalism, and so forth. And if it's fair to Marx, you can't look at Marx's Kapital and ignore Marx, who's also describing social movements and so forth. And that, I think, would be my defense of Marx.
Right. Well, you can ignore all those things, of course. You can ignore them. But yes, it's a Polanyi-esque reading of Marx. Great.
Actually to the middle part of the volume on Capital before you get to chapter 25. Because once you're at chapter 25, then there is...
So this is what happens when you get your Capital Marx. Chapter this, verse that. This is going back to the 70s.
Shall I ask him early? Shall I take you on the list?
No, the next one.
Sorry. No?
just you need to be following up on...
Okay.
I was just being more Jessup than
okay.
Impossible. I guess right. This is interesting. What? Automation. How many times in the history of capitalism have we heard that automation is going to get rid of labor? Many times. So the question is this time different? Well, Gary says yes, you say yes. They all said yes at the time. If you study the gig economy, and I have students who are studying the gig economy, it is like they studied the continuous flow chemical industry in the 1960s. They thought, this is automation, the end of labor, blah, 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 yeah. Now you look at the gig economy, there's an extraordinary amount of labor, even in the most advanced digitalized part. Because it's so dynamic, actually labor, unskilled labor in the Philippines, actually is the one that's actually filling the functional gaps generated by actually the dynamism of digitalization. But I may be wrong. I'm happy to be wrong. If you're right, then this is a process of what? Ex-commodification. It doesn't no way threatening the Polanyi or my rereading or false rereading of Polanyi. It is indeed, automation is precisely a process of excommodification. And the question is, what happens to those who are excommodified, displaced? How do they survive? How are they excluded? What is the experience of exclusion? And what social movements do they generate? So that would be the follow-up from the question of automation.
I have the next question in the fourth row. Yes, the microphone is coming.
Okay. Hi, my name is Ernst Hollander, and I'm from Sweden, which might explain some of my concerns. First, just let me say it's fantastic to see you IRL, as the young people say. In real life.
In Brazil, they couldn't believe they could see me. They thought I was dead 20 years ago. Did you think I was dead 20 years ago? Okay.
No. I read, but didn't see it. And I'm a political economist and not a sociologist. So it's. There was two things in your talk that I reacted to a bit. First, it was this time frame of the movements and the fascist movements, because I think that since neoliberalism emerged in the 70s, we have had this financialization, or what you say, producing both movements of what I would call emancipatory movements and retrograde counter movements also. So this is maybe I'm completely wrong, but I understood the term counter movement as not saying anything about whether it's progressive or non-progressive. And then again, not until the end did you talk about the retrograde counter movements. So this brings me into my two questions. First, whether you think that this is a reasonable term at all to talk about. The fascist movements, they are trying to, with false consciousness and everything, defend some kind of narrow interests. So this is also a kind of anti-market or anti-capital movement or anti-whatever. And then I just want to say, you called information a fictitious commodity. I introduced in the paper for this conference, or also earlier, semi-fictitious commodities, because in Sweden this has gone very far. Sweden is the first to use the Friedmanian voucher plan for schools. And the whole HEW, which you say in the US, health, education, and welfare, has been commodified, financialized, and the profits sent to tax havens, be they Cayman Islands or
Sweden.
Yeah. And this, I think one has to either introduce a category of semi-fictitious commodities, or just call extend the list to your information, but also a number of things that obviously fills Polanyi's criteria that to make markets of them and to financialize them tears apart the very nerve basics of society. But this is, who could think of making education, making child care, making elder care into commodities 80 years ago? But now you can, obviously, or as you see. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Ivan from Jena University, and thank you very much. I think you are reaching your aim to provoke thinking debate and hopefully also gaining some common ground. I have one question and two observations. The question is, why do you put, why do you call the third wave, or why do you link it to the environmental catastrophe? It seems a bit fashionable, but is it, does it have an analytical position in your third wave? It's just everybody talks about the planetary crisis, this crisis of killing civilization. Just for, I work on environmental stuff, but the danger is always if you talk about the planetary crisis or catastrophe, also might be hypothesizing because it's so huge, climate change. The second is, if we talk here about, it's about a question, since we are in this conference, also for other debates, I like this this thought that commodification means endangering of the use value. This is Polanyi, of course, Marx, I think, and also wanted to hit at that, and the undermining of the sources of wealth. But my point is, if you understand, or should we add one aspect to your analysis, or to our analysis, that capitalism at the global scale is highly uneven, we know this, and that the maintenance of the use value of the fictitious commodities, but also of other commodities, might be more and more maintained, the use, let's say, the livable social conditions in the capitalist centers, but also in the urban centers of the global south, by externalizing the preconditions and the negative consequences of the mode of production or of the, and the mode of living. So shouldn't we look more carefully to understand contemporary capitalisms at this uneven capitalist dynamics and at these highly, I would say, highly relevant abilities of certain societies to externalize the preconditions and the negative consequences? And I think this is quite important for
North-South relations.
No, North-South relations, but even within China, within Brazil, what happens in Sao Paulo at the cost of the Amazon and so on. And of course, talking and thinking it with Gramsci and the notion of hegemony, how can certain material relations, but social relations, can be maintained or reducible, if you like, in certain regions at the cost of others. And I'm interested in how can we complement Polanyi and Marx with this. And my third remark is on, as Abba said, on your understanding of the counter-movements within this process of marketization. I also think that this dichotomization is problematic. Aside, since Brigitte is chairing the session, that you have a very, very reduced understanding of production when you link it to class struggle and to inclusion. So there is such a feminist debate that the production process should be understood in a much broader sense. The post-opera, this debate, social ecology, and Andreas' movie, that production is not just this traditional production, but it's a social production and reproduction. And then we could link it, I think, with counter movements. But my point is more an empirical one. I was several times at the World Social Forum, because you argue that, unfortunately, the counter movement, it should be global, but it went left to the national. And I was there between the first and the last ones in Porto Alegre, in Belém, in Dakar, and the diagnosis of the alter, globalization movement, or of the global counter movement, as you put it, was that it's so difficult to have a global struggle. And it makes sense to go back to the national scale, and the whole Arab Spring, the Occupy movement, was not by chance, mainly and taking place at the national scale, but having a very internationalist agenda. At the other point, also empirically, at the last World Social Forums, the last day, were not the let's say, global call for resistance, alternatives, and so on, but there were, if I remember right, in the last one in Porto Alegre, there were 24 working groups on very concrete issues, mining, gender, water, and right to the city, whatever you can imagine, yeah. And my suggestion is to think more carefully that against the background of a problematic experience of the ultra-globalization movement, to bring everything together, that it went back to the national scale in some way, I already mentioned, but also that we need to think global counter-movements within specific issue areas. And this is not to be particularistic, as many say, but I think this is to bring together the concrete experiences. I work on mining conflicts in Latin America, and the mining conflicts in Latin America are organized at a global scale. And they have the concrete particularities And this is not the same as the right to the city or the gender issues and so on. And I would say if we understand global counter-hegemony movements like this, we can avoid these dichotomization that now they're weak and they go back to the national scale, but we should look more carefully. And just to end, this is not only about decommodification. It's very much about identities, but it's also against exploitation, and we could add others. So my point is, of course, if you have this schema, the schemes you need to kind of polarize, but if we look more carefully at the concrete level, we'll find all these motivations of counter-hegemonic struggles.
Thank you. Thank you. And then, as the next question, microphone, please, yes. Thank you.
Hi, I'm David Wood from the London School of Economics, and I have two things to say, which I'll try to help questions, but maybe they'll be in vain. Wouldn't you agree that that questions? The first is that you may or may not know that Britain has recently introduced a new £5 note. It's amazing. It's plastic. It's flexible. It's strong. It's really the most remarkable piece of money I've ever held. And it seems that clever people have figured out that if you fold it properly, you can even use it as a needle on a record player to play your vital records. So there's an instance of money having a use value. but it seems to me that, in general, it's pretty hard to get to make this notion of use value work with money. And to me, that points to a problem in what you had to say in your very inspiring talk, which was that you really, really want to hold on to this notion of fictitious commodity and say, okay, there's something about land, labor, and money that they all go together. And then you talk about, well, the experience of commodification is an important driver of political movements. Sure, for labor, but you know, land is not evolving, you know, counter-movement thoughts from its dirt brain, you know? I mean, it's the experience of commodification for land is a totally different thing because land doesn't have an experience. So I'm just thinking that maybe the arguments you want to make would be better served, and I think, in fact, what you said would be better served without the fictitious commodity notion. You can't get into your reformulation, I don't think you can get really either. Maybe you could get land, but I don't think you can get money into the reformulation. So the second thing I wanted to say has to do with the counter-movement and the alignment saying, well, if there is the movement towards market liberalization, there will also be the counter-movement. I think that that's true, but a big part of the causal story of the Great Transformation, in my view, is actually barriers to the counter-movement. What stalemates or deadlocks the counter-movement? A lot of people, when they read Polanyi, they seem to think that fascism is part of the counter-movement, and I heard maybe an echo of that in what you said, that the global counter-movement might not look pretty. But I actually think that fascism in the Great Transformation arises as a result of the blocking of the counter-movement. The fact that the financial markets are able to hold democratic governments hostage through the threat of financial panic, stalemating protective measures. And that procedure, that holding hostage blocks the counter-movement, weakens society, and weakens the resistance to fascism. What's interesting about formulating the argument that way is you can look for other barriers to the counter-movement, not just the power of finance. What Polanyi has to say about the wonderful U.S. Constitution is that it was designed to separate the people from power over their economy. What blocked a productive response to the financial crisis in the U.S. in a lot of ways was the separation of powers in the U.S. Constitution. So again, if you want to look at the origins of what's happening in the USA, you might say this isn't an example of the counter-movement. This is the resistance to society being weakened by a blocking of the counter-movement, in this case not by the power of finance, so much as the structure of U.S. political institutions. So those were my two questions.
Thank you very much.
I got so caught up with what the people were saying. Sweden, right. Yeah, I'm just trying to recall, I'm sorry. Yes, you were talking about this selling apps, right? All right. Yeah, what you said reminded me actually of what Nancy Fraser has written, and she's argued that there's not a double movement, there's a triple movement. And what we have to think about is not just marketization leading to social protection, but there's an emancipatory movement. Emancipatory movements of the 1960s and 70s are what she puts in there. And my response is there is really no, there's no sort of institutional basis, clear institutional basis for those movements. I much prefer to think about the relationship between state and society as the terrain for social movements, as opposed to the Polanyian market and society. But you talk about, so I agree with her that there may be, that's a possibility to have three types of movements. You had two, you had the emancipatory and the retrograde. But there may be there may be the emancipatory, there may be the protectionist, and there may be the sort of the progressive marketization. But anyway, you raised some really interesting questions about alternative fictitious commodities and the idea of a semi-fictitious commodity. I have no objections to that at all. I think what it means is as soon as we start including a longer list, and one can't reduce, an argument that one can't reduce, I don't know, childcare, for example, to labor, and that service, the service sector provides a whole slew of semi-fictitious commodities, then I think we have to think about what on earth we really do mean by fictitious commodity. It forces that question. And I think that still needs to be elaborated. If David doesn't want me to drop the whole concept, of course that might happen. But yeah, I think what's interesting, again, with Nancy Fraser, what does she argue very interestingly, is that the commodification of labor power has brought women into the force and generated what she calls a care deficit. So that is one of the consequences of the commodification of labor power. So the question is whether you can actually link some of your social services as semi-fictitious to actually the commodification of the, or particularly of labor. But anyway, that I assume you'll be giving a paper on that, so I will listen attentively. I think that is a question. As soon as I bring in knowledge, then the sky's the limit. Like you can bring in all sorts of other ideas. I think the most important thing is it raises the question of what on earth we actually really do mean by fictitious commodity, and whether we should, as David suggests, give it yes. All right. Well, I might as well talk about David's question, right? Well, money. I mean, I don't. The use value of money is that I can go to a restaurant and give them a bill. That's what I see the use value of money. It doesn't have to be used on a record player. I mean, and money also is a very convenient way of measuring money. That's what I thought the use value of money is. And when actually the value of money, and this is Polanyi speaking now, when the value of money changes rapidly, because exchange rates are changing rapidly, then you have inflation of a dramatic kind, as you know, and happened in the early 90s in post-Soviet Russia, then it loses its capacity to actually be useful, to be a measure of value in exchange. And yeah, and the second question on fascism, well, I guess I have to think about this again. I mean, this is great. I mean, I have to think about so many things. But yeah, fascism is part of the counter movement. I've never thought of it in any other way. Not as a blockage, but actually as part of the counter movement. And to think that the counter movement is only progressive. I mean, I thought the whole point of Polanyi's argument was that, you know, marketization goes and increases. And one of the responses is fascism, and that's the one he was concerned about. So
I'm an Orthodox Polanyian. I think that's definitely my view, is that fascism is part and parcel of the camp. Perhaps I didn't emphasize it enough, but last night it was all about that. Last night I understood from my, you know, I didn't understand everything last night, but that's what I understood. And anyway, all right. So yes, so Uli Brandt, yes. Yes, now that's very interesting, the uneven development of capitalism and how youth value can be sustained in some parts at the expense of other parts. Well, this is an old Swedish story that, you know, we always criticize Sweden because basically it was able to sort of expand because it was actually sort of expelling certain of the contradictions of capitalism to other places. I think that... Yeah, that's an interesting question to concretize that. And one could argue that, you know, even in, as you were suggesting, in China or in South Africa, that the sustenance of an urban, quote, proletariat, though it becoming ever more precarious, is indeed at the expense of a displaced population in the, what were the reserved areas in South Africa. And equally, one can talk about that in China, that the hukou system really established a sort of labor aristocracy in the towns, did in the past, and at the expense of the rural areas. So I think, yes, I think that dynamism between shall we call it advanced and peripheral areas is indeed something that one should examine, and how use values are sustained in the face of commodification. Yes. Well, I don't know, I look forward to learning about, we sort of agree that the 2011 movements of the street, as I called them, were nationally framed and nationally organized, but clearly globally connected. And World Forum is obviously one place where they were globally connected and influenced one another. How can one not recognize Arab Spring was something that sort of begins in Tunisia and moves to Egypt, and that there is a mutual influence, and a mutual influence between Arab Spring and the Occupy movement, but they're still constituted in a national way. The question is whether there is any foundation for your claim, and I hope there is, that there is an emergent actual, more than just a connectedness, but actually a solidarity that fights collectively against, as a global level against global challenges or in response to global challenges. And so I think that's a part of the debate. I mean, you're right, I was very dismal about this, and I have been in many other places, particularly in connection with labor. But yeah, I love to hear the counter argument. Yeah. No, I haven't. I'll answer three. As far as I know.
Okay. Can you talk about the environmental catastrophe?
Sorry? The environmental catastrophe.
Yes.
You're right, absolutely, yes. Well, it's pounding to the public. I think that it is not actually the commodification, we were talking with Carrie yesterday, it's not actually necessarily the commodification of nature. It is the plundering or exploitation of nature that actually, in some ways, is the problem. Because economists say it is, we've got to basically give the environment a price. We've got to create a market in carbon emissions to actually protect the environment. So the problem is that there's not a market, some people would argue. So I think that there is a commodification of nature, though that was no doubt, and even Marx was saying it, but there is also the plundering or exploitation of nature. And when we think about global warming, I think one has to think about it as the plundering of nature, the exploitation of nature, not necessarily its commodification. Not that its commodification would be a solution. What we know about carbon trading or cap and trade doesn't lead us to be very optimistic. But the question is whether social movements, environmental social movements, and you know much more about it than I do, but whether environmental social movements can be as successful as they were perhaps in the 1970s, or whether we have to rely upon enlightened capitalists to actually figure out that capitalism will disappear if they don't get their act together. Of course, that was one interpretation of one of
Marx's interpretations of the factory acts that they, you know, some enlightened capitalists saw that this might be necessary. Of course, it was the interest of enlightened capitalists because they would push out the small capitalists as a result of the factory acts. But anyway, the question is really, how do we think about this issue of the embarrassment, the environmental catastrophe in a Polanyi scheme? Yeah.
At the moment, I have no questions anymore. We can make a next round if there are still some coming. Yes. Somebody else? Yes. And the last call. Okay. Yes. Somebody else for this last round? Okay. Then we have these two questions, Kai, and the last corner. Yes. There, yeah, please. Thank you.
Can you share? Thank you for your fantastic speech. I'm also from the Global South section, and seen from a global perspective, I would question the distinction between class struggle and counter movement. And I think you did that in a paper. I can't remember the name of the paper, but I think I read that. But I want to make that point strong now, because both commodification and exploitation are root causes of misery in the uneven and combined development of capitalism. And they happen simultaneously, and they often come together in one person, seen from the global south, because wage labor is maybe a very short time experience for most of the people in the global south. And we know from the feminist research from Madison and many others that semi-proletarianization is the norm in the global south. So seen from this perspective, I think that there is more room for thinking about counter-movements or what comes together in movements against exploitation and commodification. They may emerge.
In this corner,
So my name is Paula Valderrama from the Free University in Berlin. I'm working a couple of years already with Polanyi, and I have some 3 points about this theory, which I don't agree. The first part is your thesis about Polanyi's optimism. So I do understand that there are a couple of places in the Great Transformation where he says the market economy will not exist, but there are also many other places in the Great Transformation, but also in other texts, where he is very aware about the school of Mises, for example, about Hayek, for example, and he knows very well that this is a possibility, that market radicalism or market communism comes. So I don't think that it's where that he is sure that market radicalism doesn't come. So in original planning, this is written 1945, he's talking about liberal capitalism that is also an alternative. So this is my first point. The second point, it was already said about the counter-movement. I would also suggest not read it in a progressive way. Not to read it in a progressive way. In the first page of the Great Transformation, he says that the market principle causes a reaction, the counter movement, but this reaction causes also problems and endangers the society. So I think it's very important to say that the counter movement is also a kind of danger. I think he's talking that the consequence is fascism. So I would also support the idea that fascism is not a counter movement, but it's a consequence of the crisis between the counter movement and the market principle. So I think we need to the difference between the categories of democratic socialism by Polanyi and the counter movement. So the counter movement is not the solution, and also fascism and state socialism as separated also from the counter movement.
Thank you very much. I don't see any questions anymore. I would if you would conclude my
talk. Yes. Just came to my mind, I read an article about Chesser where he's speaking about communitarianism about urban governance in his how neoliberal social relations are embedded into actually, or in urban design, how they would be applied in communities, and how they were part of the labor third wave, and this kind of stuff. So I was thinking about, isn't the state actually engaging actively in re-embedding, in socially re-embedding the capitalist relations now?
Yeah.
Or since the 90s.
And what are you talking about?
I'm talking about...
What part of the world?
This is the US, this is England and France, Holland. It's everywhere where new communitarianism showed up in urban planning. But maybe Bob would tell us more about it. I was just thinking of...
I see new communitarianism as a flanking and supporting mechanism to enable neoliberalism to continue. So it's not a counter-reaction, it is simply something introduced to enable the neoliberal project to continue by cooling out the mark.
Are there still any more questions? I don't see anybody at the moment. Okay, then I would like to first in France when it comes to the conclusion.
Okay. Well, Karen, yes. I mean, I suppose I have a vision, Karen, of exploitation in the global south of a relatively stabilized labor force. Sometimes used to be called the labor aristocracy. And then I'm opposed to that. Those are excluded. But what you're saying, of course, is that is a false dichotomy. And that perhaps, I will think you're right, that there is a context here in which the exploitation and the commodification come together. And in that you might argue that the very notion of precarity is itself the intersection of exploitation and commodification. So yes, I will move to the concrete from the abstract. So yes, I will. Right, good. Excuse me. Well, yes, in your power, right, wherever you are. There you are. I'm delighted to hear this. That's not how I read The Great Transformation and the other articles of Polanyi that I read. There are places, I wish I had the quote here, where he basically does say that this is not going to happen again, but there may be other places where he says other things. And in a sense, I would expect him to. I mean, he can't be a line through history. You know, in the past we made a mistake, in the future we'll not make mistakes. But he didn't have a theorization, he did not have a theorization, in my view, of where marketization comes from. And if we want to contest marketization, then we have to know what is the force behind it. And I don't think he had any theory of capitalism that allowed him to assess what is the force behind marketization. I don't know what to say about this. I mean, my mind is disrupted by this idea that fascism, and now you say socialism, is not part of the counter-movement. And so I guess we've got 4 days to figure this out. This is great. I think it's fantastic that we have competing understandings of what Polanyi says, and competing visions of how we may sort of rebuild it, and that's why it's really important to recognize that this has got to be done very differently in different parts of the world. We mustn't do this in segregated world, we must do this in a conversation with one another. Because ultimately, I still do believe that if humanity is to save itself, we have to think about it. That's why the word counter-movement is so crucial to me, in my view. We have to think about what is it that will either contain capitalism, or if not contain it, go beyond it. I mean, this is the big question that Polanyi raises today. And so it's great that we can be talking to one another precisely along these lines. And I'm happy to revise my revision of Polanyi
can learn from the great patterns that await us. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this opening speech and for the discussion. And thank you for all these inspiring ideas. So, I still have three organizational details which are rather important, I think. The most important is that I have to acknowledge and I want to mention the staff behind this conference in the administration and registration and in contact with the media is working Heidemarie Schütz, Corinna Sonnleitner, and Astrid Stieger. And technical support for the rooms are given in responsibility Karl Bayer and Matthias Astleitner, and support for the book table I mentioned the next gift, Katrin Wirte. Thank you very much for all your support. So then I have to announce that we in the second floor have a book table. The book table is professionally organized by Bernd Köster, and he has prepared a book table with the organizers and the publishers, so it's specialized on this conference. And if you are interested in recent publications on our issues, our themes, our discussions, you might find, may find a lot of books, books of authors who are here, books of authors who are not here, and I think it's very interesting because Bernd Köstner does that really professionally, and he is has a very interesting collection with him. That's in the second floor, and as you know, we don't have fees for the conference. We decided to make this conference fee free. And you all know that's a little bit difficult. So we have really in Austria two now rich universities, and we have global budget, and we are not allowed to do whatever we want to do with these budgets. But it's possible for us to give you a catering with coffee, tea, water for free in the breaks and in the lunch break, in the afternoon break with sandwiches and coffee and cake, and this evening to invite you to an Austrian wine and beer reception. All this is in the second floor. All breaks, all primaries are here. The breaks in the second floor beside the book table, and the sessions will start not in this building, but in the Science Park 1. The Science Park 1 is just a few minutes, 3 or 4 minutes on the direction straight downhill from this building. And if you will start tomorrow in the morning, you have to go first to the Science Park 1 and not to this building. So. Thank you very much for your attention, for the discussion. It's not possible to let your baggage PCs and so in this room, because we cannot guarantee that it's closed in the evening and night. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.